Today we're going to study page 32. We study Mishnah, the Holy Mishnah on page 31b. Mi shenadar benazir v'nish'al lechacham v'asaro. Ah, typical case. Someone make a commitment. For example, commitment of being nazir. Regardless if it was intentional or not intentional, the Meiri said. The idea is he made the commitment. And later, he asks halachic authority, he asks the rabbi, and he says, guess what, you are nazir. And meanwhile, he did a lot of violations, right? Because people sometimes like to make the rules by themselves. You know, they think they know everything, right? So therefore, the Mishnah said, since he go before halachic authority, va'asaro, he said, you know what you said a couple of weeks ago, or whatever it is, you have Kabbalat Nizirut, you accept upon yourself to be Nazir. So, Monem Misha'a Shenadar. So, here the big question is, so how you count now? Nazir is how many days? Basic Nazir is 30 days. Let's say week passed by. So when you start counting, so he said, you count, you go back the time that he commit himself. Even he drank wine in between. Nish'al Chacham v'hitiro. So if he go before the halachic sage and he annul, which means he said, you know what you said is, it doesn't carry anything. Now, you should remember when we study Nedarim, in the tractate Nedarim, page 21, we learn that Chacham, unlike husband, can oker lemafreya, can go uprooted to the original commitment. But here, you can go and said that he said that he's not any manner of nezirut. So, by the way, there is a Sfat Emet, very interesting here. The Sfat Emet said, for example, if he contaminated to a dead body, So he explained that basically what happened here is he nitma litmei metim, he touched someone who attached to dead body, which is the second decree. Anyway, hayta lo be'ema meforeshet, meaning it's already designated an animal, as we discussed in the past several days, for the end of the nezirut. Tetzeh v'tireh ba'eder. Forget about it. It's like regular animal. It's chulin. It's unconsecrated. It doesn't have any sanctity. Amru b'tireh le'beit shamai. Yatem odim b'zeh shu ekdesh ta'ut. Don't you think that this is a mistaken, erroneous consecration of animal? Shetetzeh v'tireh ba'eder. So why previously you said that Hekdesh Beta'ut, some erroneous Hekdesh, is not. Amru lahem, Beit Shammai respond to Beit Hillel, I atem odim b'mi sheta'a v'kara tshi'i asiri v'l'asiri tshi'i v'l'achad asar asiri shehu mekudash. Part of that is when you see the flock, kevakarat ro'e edro, you see the moving, you count, 1, 2, 3, etc., etc. So he said, when a person make a tithe, how you do in the animal's tithe? You know, we talk about mitzvah in the Torah, to have an animal tithe, that is in Leviticus 27. And you take the tenth and you bring it as an offering. So you bring all the flock to the place and you pull it to a small entrance. And you basically, you have this red sign at every tenth. That's the, and he said, this is a tithe. That's Gemara in Brachorot, page 58. So basically, when someone said, start count number 9, 10, but it was a mistake in the way that he counted. He said, Shehu Mekudash, that if he called two animals number 10, good morning, Dr. Friedman, that two animals that he count number 10, both of them, you have to agree. You have to know Jewish talk, Gilbert. You're answering with a question, right? So he count twice 10, right? Amru lahem Beit Hillel, lo, you have no proof from there. Hashevet kidsho. So it means because he passed those animals and the 10 passed by, even by mistake, it's already sanctified. Umay lo ta'avin yachet hashevet al shmini ve'al shnemasar, shemasa klum. If number 8 or number 12, he called them 10 by mistake, so you mean to say that he carries sanctity? For sure not. even he called them 10. Ela, you have to say, the reason that the 9 and the 11 sanctified, כתוב שקידש העשירי, הוא קידש התשיעי, because you have a decree, גזירת הכתוב, a decree in the text, that when the mistaken, the owner, made a mistake, he sanctified those 9 and 11, it's already part of the deal, part of the sanctification. Page 32, ואת אחד עשר, and number 11, so you have the edict of the Torah, that consecration takes effect with, you have these two animals, so that's gzirat ha-ketuv. So you cannot bring raya, you cannot bring a proof, because that's the text, that's the Torah said. So therefore, you have this number 9 and number 11, consecrate. So the Gemara said, mani matnitin, now we go with the first one. We speak in a Mishnah that said that if you have a Nazir that realized by asking a rabbi that he is Nazir, so even he drank wine, we still count those days from the beginning. Who hold that? Lo Rabbi Yossi v'lo Rabbanan. You can't tell me that neither Rabbi Yossi nor the sages. The Tanya. Mish and Adar, if someone commit himself more than 30 days, ve'avar al ziruto, he went and violated that by drinking wine during the time. En nizkakin lo, ela im ken mone ba'em isur kaimim shenag ba'em eter. So you do not help him to get out of his nezirut if you wish, or to bring his offering if you wish, only if he count those days that he did not fulfill his nezirut. For example, he commit himself for 100 days and he drank wine 60 days. So you do not go that direction until he gets the 60 days period, the same days as he was in violation. So you have to have a completion of the day. So in that sense, you need to go for 160 days to complete it. So here we said, Rabbi Yossi omer dayo 30 yom. Rabbi Yossi said, forget it. It's enough for him to have 30 days. So he's required to observe additional days of Nezirut only if he transgressed his vow of Nezirut for 30 days or more. אי רבנן קשי הנזירות מרובה, אי רבי יוסי קשי הנזירות מועטת. So you go either direction, you have a problem. Either you impose a long term, which means more than 30 days by Rabbi Rabbanan, or you go by Rabbi Yossi, it means that the minimum is 30 days. So Rabbi Yossi hold that he needs to complete all the 30 days that he violated his Nezirut, and the Mishnah hold that he does not need to complete. Now, the truth is, you have here the Rosh. The Rosh said, if you tell me that the Mishnah speaks about a person that commit himself for a long term of Nezirut and he drank wine in some of the days, it means that you count some of the days from the time he commit, and therefore he needs to go only by 30 days period. The rest of days, not so. It's go by Rabbi Yossi. Ibai Teima, you can learn Rabbi Yossi v'ibai Teima Rabbanan. Now I'll explain to you why. Ibai Teima Rabbi Yossi kan benzirut meruba, kan benzirut mu'etet. Here, if you go by the Rabbi Yossi, it means the Nezirite for more than 30 days. If you go by the in the Braita, he said it means that he committed himself for 30 days, he drank wine for all these days, so he need to complete the period of 30 days. V'ibai Teima Rabbanan, if you go by the sages, lo teima mishah shenazar. You go back from the time that he commit himself ela eima kemisha'a shenazar. You have to say that like from the time that he vowed, which means he must count his nezirut corresponding to the time that he has elapsed since he took his vow, exactly the way that stated by the sages. So you have a responsa by the Maharit. Maharit was a absolute one of the luminary sages. He asked a question, how do you define the idea of the rabbis put a fine? You have to say that a fining, in very short, only if it was intentional, if it's bemezid. And the Mishnah Lamelech elaborate, but let's continue, we're running out of time. Nish'al ha-chachamim v'itiru'o. He went before the sages and they annul So if you have already animal that was consecrated, we leave it alone, that go with the other animals. So we derive from that conclusion another statement that Beit Hillel hold. Lav Amre Beit Shammai is, and that Beit Shammai said in the Mishnah, in pages 30b and 31, Hekdesh Betauta veHekdesh. You remember we talked about it? You consecrated something, and it was erroneous, it's already consecrated, right? Kevan Deitgalai Milta Lav Shapir Nazar. Since he now discovered it was inappropriate, incongruous matter of Nezirut. So therefore you don't have the effectiveness of Nezirut. So therefore the animal that was consecrated in the conjunction to his completion of the Nezirut, Tetze V'Tir'e Ba'eder. So therefore that animal should go out and graze among the other flocks. So because only Nazir can consecrate the animal for that purpose. Even Beit Hillel hold that even you switch, remember yesterday we talked about switching offering. He said even it was a mistake, it still carried the sanctity, even he did not intend to do it. Which means that animal is still carry that sanctity. When you uprooted the sanctity, so the substitute is also uprooted, as the animal remain non-sacred. So they have a book called Minchat Chinuch. It's a very beautiful writing. And he discussed based on this point, the whole point of Teshuvah. Because when we talk about repentance, so you see here that you differentiate between mitzvot and averot, how you balance it off. He explained it beautifully based on this discussion. Amar Mar, so we learn in the Mishnah that Beit Shammai respond to Beit Hillel. I atem odim she'ilu kara, there is another nusach she'ilu ta'a, la'chi'i asiri, meaning if he made a mistake and that one who called the nine animal ten, that is consecrated, what we learn in the text, itma, ma'aser, we talk about animal tithes. Rav Nachman Amar, ta'uto velo kavanato, which means the sanctity of the tithe applies on the nine only if he called him tenth. But if he knew that he's only number nine and he intentionally called him tenth, then he's not carry that sanctity. Rav Chisda v'Rababa Rav Huna Amrei, ta'uto v'kol sheken kavanato, they said no. If he made a mistake and he sanctified the ninth, he's sanctified. But how much so if it was in his intent? So the Tosfot explained what we said, that if someone is mistaken and he called nine, that is ten, it's not necessarily bedavka. But the Mishnah wants to tell us that the ninth is sanctified even it was erroneous, but for sure if he did it with intent. Amar le Rava le Rav Nachman, le didach de amar ta'uto velo kavanato. According to your view that you said that his mistake and not his intent sanctified the ninth, de ka'amrei Beit Shammai le Beit Hillel, when the Beit Shammai said to Beit Hillel in the Mishnah, I atem odim she'ilu kara la tshi'i asiri vela asiri tshi'i, you agreed that if he called the ninth ten, the tenth nine, the 11th tenth, that all these three sanctify. So you have here a proof that this Iranian sanctification took place. Ve'ishteku Beit Hillel, and Beit Hillel was quiet, which means did not respond to that question. So the truth is, Beit Hillel did not express the quietness, but they respond that the rule is that the 8 and the 12, you see a proof that the sanctification of the animal's tithe affected the 9th and the 11th. It's the decree, the biblical decree. But Rava asked, what's the reason that Beit Hillel kept quiet from reject rejecting the body of the proof of Beit Shammai. The Rosh said, why they are not, why they bring a total new scenario of the 8 and the 12. So he said, Leimron Lehon, Beit Hillel should respond to Beit Shammai, Ma lema'aser sheken eno kadosh bechavana, what you tell me, that the tithe, the number 9, if he call him 10, is not sanctified with that intent. So he said, Amar Rav Shimi Barashi hainu ta'ama de lo amrei lehon. This is the reason that Beit Hillel did not say in response to Beit Shammai, de kal vachomer hu, which means Beit Shammai can respond that the reason that the ninth did not carry the sanctity, if he did it with intent, it can prove with kal vachomer. Ma maaser sheino kadosh, meaning if someone called the ninth 10 bechavana with total intent, kadosh betaut, so nevertheless the sanctity is confirmed with such designation done by mistake. Hekdesh shekadosh bechavana lo kol sheken, but if you have here a general sanctity that the sanctity is confirmed deliberately, which means that it was in ordinary situation of some the person that who consecrated it, how much so? So he said, velohi, it's not certain. Why? Dekdesh bedaata demarei tlei. When it comes to consecration, it depends on the intention of the person who owns it. So therefore it's all depend upon the kavanah, the intent of the owner. So it's not take effect if it was a mistake. Versus when it's tied, we have gzerata katuv, we have a clear edified, right? The statement from the text that they said that the sanctification will not take effect of the 9, only if you call him by mistake 10th. So you cannot derive from that to other manner of consecration. 2 points. One, it is the great Kloisenburger Rebbe, the great rabbi of the Hasidic sect in Netanya called Kloisenburg Tzanz. So someone came to him with a question. It was a fellow that was Galmud, was a childless, never have a family, lived by himself in an apartment in Israel, in Netanya. And the person wants to, they build a new yeshiva, and he wanted to have the yeshiva owns that apartment with one stipulation, that the rents go for the yeshiva. So they came to him and tried to convince him that since they need to build the institution, to pay the teachers, to do all the needs for the yeshiva institution, it's much better for them, if he really wants to do it right, to sell it, to sell that expensive apartment. The man blatantly refused. He said, no, the only thing I want you to be the trustees, to keep it after I'm passing, and to take the money and have it for the whatever you need for general budget. So he passed away. And several years later, they have such a financial daring that they have a choice, either to close up the institution, or the only valuable left was that apartment. So they went to this great Hasidic Rebbe and asked him a question, what do you do now? In one hand, he appointed them legally as a trustees. So as a trustees, they can do whatever they want. On the other hand, he have a personal stipulation that they should not sell it, but use only the rent. So he brought the Maharsham, which we discussed in the past. And the Maharsham said that there is a concept that called umdena. Umdena meaning you have to reflect, to meditate, to evaluate, to think that the deceased, he is here. The spirit of the deceased is here. So imagine if you're bringing the deceased here and you have a conversation, look, the yeshiva is very close to you. You want the yeshiva to survive. Here are the choice. Either they're selling this apartment or closing up the building. So we knew, closing up the institution. So we knew, in one hand, he doesn't want at that time to sell it because he felt that there are other resources to keep the institution. But since he's now questioned either way, he assumed that you allow to go ahead and sell it because the final intent of the deceased was to keep the institution alive. Second point I would like to mention is the great book called Sha'agat Aryeh, and it's another book called Minchat Chinuch. Based on this sugya, ask a question. Since we talk about the animal tithes, and we explained several times that the owner of the animal need to pick and choose, and if it was all kind of mistakes. So the question is, can the owner go and have lehisha el al ma'asar be'ma? Can he go and ask halachic authority over mistakes he made in the animal tithe? So the big back and forth is based on this sugya, if in a practical way you can do that or not. Mishnah. Mi shenadar benazir, one who took a vow of nazirite. If you remember in the past, we discussed several avenues to get out of vows. One of them is called petach, meaning you find a way, you ask the vower, if you know that that's what's happened or that will happen as a result of that vow, you still hold at that time to make such a vow. So someone made a decision to be Nazir with the mindset that in the completion he brings certain animals at the end as a offering. V'alach le'avid b'emto. So now he finishes Nazirite period. He's going to collect to bring his animal, and guess what happened? Umtza'a shignigneva. And guess what happened? It disappeared. It was stolen. So now he regretted the whole manner of his Nazirut, which is 30 days, because he doesn't want to spend the money to buy another animal. So he comes to halachic authority and he asks a question, is that okay? So the answer is, im ad shelo nigneva be'emto nazar. If that happened, that we know, when he make this commitment of being Nazirite, the animal was there, Harei ze nazir, meaning even he goes before the halachic authority, he cannot dissolve, he cannot annul his vow by saying, okay, I have a petach, I have opening, I have charata, I regret it, because if he knew in advance that this animal will be stolen, he still make that commitment, because it's very unlikely, it's very unoften, it's not happened right away that someone steal his animal. So meaning, we don't have pticha benolad, we don't have the opening of getting out of vow by assumption of, predeposition, something like pre-plan, set a plan that the animal will be stolen. 32b, ve'im mishinigneva behemto nazar, but if he took a vow of Nezirut after his animal was stolen, meaning he did not know when he makes that vow that the animal is already stolen. Now he regretted of his Nezirut. A no Nazir, he is not a Nazirite, as it is retroactively established that his vow was taking an error from the outset, as he relied on the animal he did not possess. So, based on this, you can ask a question about Kalba Savua and Rabbi Akiva. We all know the story, right? That he disassociate, disown him from his. How come later on, when he turns to be Rabbi Akiva, all of a sudden they allow? So the big question is, if that's considering Nolad, if that's considering Shachiach. Anyway, V'zot ta'ut ta'a Nachum Amadi. It was a great, great rabbi by the name of Nachum, was part of the people of the late part of the time of the destruction of the Second Temple. And the Gemara in Avodah Zarah, page 7, describe him as the one of the luminary people, Dayanei Gzerot. Anyway, he thought that by having Ptichat Neder Benolad, that you can have an opening for regret, for act of contrition and remorse, that it's unusual. So what happened is, Kshealu Nezirim Minagola, when the Jewish people came out of exile and ascend to Yerushalayim in order to bring the offering. So Umatzu Bet HaMikdash Chareb, imagine, you have people who are Nezirim, can be 30 days, can be many years. And they, with the great dream, planning to complete their Nezirut, taking their offering to Jerusalem, and all of a sudden they turn that the temple is destroyed. So now they stuck. They cannot bring their offering, and therefore for everlasting, for the rest of their life, they have to remain Nezirim. So they come before the Dayanei Gzerot, before the luminary sage of Nahum, and they ask him to let them out. For those who look, why his not name is Rabbi? So you should know that there is a rule called Gadol Merabban Shmo. In a Talmudic time, it was a, such a level of humbleness that if you use just the name of the sage, that's the highest recognition, opposite than what you know today. You have rabbi, doctor, professor, cantor, whatever. In those days, without titles, that's the highest person. Amar lahem Nahum Amadi, Ilu hayitem yodim shebet hamikdash charev, hayitem nozrim. If you knew in advance, when you make this commitment of being Nazir, that the temple is going to be destroyed, do you still make that commitment of being Nazirite? Meaning that you will not be able to bring the offering and you're stuck for life in Nazirut? Amru lo lo, they said definitely not. So therefore, Vehetiran Nahum Amadi, so Nahum Amadi dissolved the vow for them. So, Vukshaba davar etzel chachamim, when the matter came before the sages, Amru, Kol shenazar ad shelo harav bet hamikdash nazir, who anyone who committed himself to be nazir until the destruction of the temple is a nazir. Why? Because the destruction of the temple, it's petach, it's opening of nolad, of upcoming. Because it's very unusual to have a matter of day by day that all of a sudden the temple destroyed. So, meaning people make the vows even if they know that there is an option that the temple destroyed. Umishacharav bet hamikdash, unfortunately, from the moment after the temple was destroyed, eino nazir, he is not a Nazirite. And he vowed based on erroneous assumption. So, now the Gemara said, Amar Rabba, shtafuhu rabbanan le Rabbi Eliezer. It's like the Rivan said, like, switch. The sages swept Rabbi Eliezer away from his previous opinion and brought him over to their opinion. As Rabba proceed to demonstrate. Ve'ukmei b'shititau ditnan, we learn in the Mishnah and tractate Nedarim, page 64, potchin benolad, if someone come to release a vow on the basis of unexpected development, divrei Rabbi Eliezer, V'chachamim Mosrin, the sages said that that the vow cannot release on this basis. V'amar Rava, af al gav damru rabanan ein potchim benolad. Even the sages said that we cannot release a vow on the basis of unexpected development. Aval potchim bitnai nolad. But they agree that we may release a vow on the basis of an argument pre-dictated on an unexpected development. Hey Chedami, give me an example. Amri Leon Ilu Ata Inish Vamar Lechon Decharav Bet HaMikdash. If someone, if at the time of your vow, someone had come and said to you that the temple will be destroyed, Mi Hava Nadritun, will you have vowed? Amar Yosef, Yehavai Atam, if I was there, when the sages said to Nahum Amadi that the Beit HaMikdash, the destruction is upcoming, Ava Amina Lechon, I will respond to them and say to them, Haktiv, they said in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 7, verse 14, Heichal Hashem, Heichal Hashem, Heichal Hashem. They said three times the word, the sanctuary of God. So why is it three times? Ze Mikdash Rishon, U'Mikdash Sheni. That's application to the first temple, the second temple, and the third temple that we rebuild soon. Meaning, I'll say to the sages that the destruction of the temple is not nolad, because you see derivative from the prognostication of Jeremiah that even the second temple will be destroyed, because that's the word the Rosh brought from the book of Jeremiah that said, Al tivtechu lachem el divrei ha-sheker, el divrei ha-sheker lemor echal Hashem, echal Hashem, echal Hashem eima. So Jeremiah rebuke, admonish the wicked people that they in a way wants to live for fun, drinking, have fun, and not worry for the destruction that's coming. And they said, come on, even the temple will destroy, it will be second one. And even he destroy, we'll have the third one. So therefore, Beit HaMikdash, the destruction was not an upcoming new things. So you can find a way to release the vow of all those Nezirim. Even let's say they knew that it's destroyed, but they have no idea when it will be destroyed. So Amar Abaye, ve'lo yadin le'emat, they really do not know, because if you find the calculation, ve'aktiv, they said in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, Shevo'im shiv'im nechtach alamcha v'al ir kodshecha. The book of Daniel said that 77th are decreed upon your people and upon your sacred city. So it means that the seventh sabbatical year, that's the decree upon you and upon Yerushalayim, the holy city. So from this prophecy, they knew, they make the calculation that 70 times 7 is 490 years from the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash, if you count the 420 years for the second Beit HaMikdash plus the 70 years in between them, it's all together 490 years. So since they knew what year the Beit HaMikdash destroyed, so the second, the destruction of Beit HaMikdash is not an opening of Nolad. So even according to the sages that disputed Nachum Amadi, it should be befitting to release the vow from that point. I don't want to go to Kabbalah, but I want you to know there is a song of Bar Yochai. In the song of Bar Yochai, there is a Kav Yarok Mechadesh Chodashim. There is a phase, Kabbalistic phase, that speaks about the circle of the 7 times 7, the sabbatical year, the messianic era. And it's a book called Recanati that he dealt based on this Gemara of the concept of the sabbatical 7 times 7s in conjunction to our time. We are 57, 76. We're getting close to messianic era, and you see a lot of signals for that. Ve'akate miyad inan behei yoma, and still did they know which day it will be destroyed. So therefore, even someone committed himself to be Nazir at that year, and he have an assumption that the destruction will not take place during his Nazirite, and he make this vow, even he thought of the option that the building will be destroyed. So it means that the Churban Beit HaMikdash, destruction of the temple, it was a petach of Nolad, was opening, and therefore you cannot release a vow from that point. Now, several points I want to make. Number one, it was a city called Osatin. It's the name of a city that was in the border between Russia and Poland, but it was on the Russian side. And the story goes, I'm not mentioning names, it was an important rabbi that had the Polish citizenship. And the relationship between Poland and Russia was ups and downs in such a level all the time that the Russian constantly changed the rules. So unfortunately, one day they came out with a decree that anybody who have a Polish citizenship and not pure Russian citizenship should be out of the country. That forced the rabbi right away to collect his packages and move the other side of the border. So what happened is he used to sneak in the border in order to give response to a halachic question of his community from time to time. people just collected their questions and used to come in so and so, and he come back and he was back and forth, and it's like appearance that he's giving up hope of holding his pulpit in Russia while he's living now in Poland. So somebody from that community start functioning as their polsek. He wasn't the rabbi, he wasn't the leader, but he start operating in that way. So the rabbi came back and he said, you know, you can't do that. So it was a great Maharsham, which mentioned several times, was a very well-known halachic figure. He called and the rabbi said, look, it wasn't Yeush, I didn't give up. I just did it for several reasons. First is the legal reason. Also, I want people to appreciate me. You know what happened with the rabbi. Sometimes you need to teach people lessons. So sometimes by not being there, people realize how much they need to have the rabbis present. But I didn't give up the pulpit. Anyway, so he based his ruling on this sugya that he still have that pulpit. I would like to conclude with a wonderful book called Nezer HaKodesh. Nezer HaKodesh is the explanation of the Midrash. So he asked a question, since we said here that it's already predicted the destruction of the second temple at the time of Jeremiah, which is the first temple. So explain to me why in the world you're building the second temple while you know it's going to be destroyed. If Jeremiah already tell you, first temple, second temple, the only the third one will stay. So why are you building the second one? So Nezer HaKodesh brought the Midrash and he said, the whole reason was a predestined by heaven to have, and the reason they did it is because the miracle of Hanukkah. It was predicted that the miracle of Hanukkah, you can call it mystically, esoterically, but it was predicted that that miracle will take place during the second temple. And as we know that even if Mashiach will come today, we still continue to celebrate the miracle of Hanukkah. So therefore, that was the spiritual cause of people to build the second temple. He proved it, for example, a statement from our forefather Yaakov Avinu, Jacob, who said in Parashat Vayetze, Ein ze ki im beit Elokim veze shara shamayim. When Jacob said, this the place that he placed his head, you remember the story, right? He ran away from his parents, he placed his head there. So he said, that place will be the house of the Lord, and this is the gate of heaven. So he explained, he says, the same way as you planting something. So how you do that? He says, you have the first attempt, you have the second attempt, they have the third one, that's the permanent, that's one that hold. So he said, here, he says, at the end, it will be Beit Elohim, at the end it will be a permanent Beit HaMikdash. But meanwhile, v'zeh, temporarily, Shar HaShamayim, is just the gate from for heaven. Why? Because the materialistic world, the occupation of people with materialism, will be a temporarily manner that occupy the first and the second, the baseless hatred, the materialism, the competition, the jealousy, the issues that between man and his fellow. He said, that's the idea. We said that Moshe Rabbeinu said at the end of the Shirat Hayam, the Song of the Sea, Mikdash Hashem konenu yadecha, meaning this will be the sanctification of you, quote unquote, anthropomorphically speaking, the hand of the Lord, that will be a permanent house. And that's the reason why they build the second temple for Hanukkah, and we pray and hope that the Beit HaMikdash, the third Beit HaMikdash, the permanent one, שיבנה במהרה בימינו, that you will rebuild soon, speedily, in our day. Amen.